have all agreed tonight, all of the speakers have agreed that America has a very serious problem. Not only does America have a very serious problem, but our people have a very serious problem. America's problem is
self-destruction.
Pictures from our time, words from long ago, police community tension, a prayer for an end, yet the song remains the same. City after city, crowds gather to shout enough, enough of dead teenagers, dead police officers, inconsolable mothers, widows of fallen cops. America may only now be coming to grips with it, but in Dallas it's an old story. A tale of two cities, a tale worth retelling, but never repeated.
Hello, I'm John McCaa. When Charles Dickens wrote of social turmoil in 18th century Paris and London in A Tale of Two Cities, he was also describing our turmoil, our nightmare that we endured July 7th, the murders of five Dallas police officers. The shocking thing is, it's happened before. Five cops killed during a period of racial tension. 1988. The gunman, criminals, and the criminally insane. Not a race hater. It was the most racially tense year in decades, but to understand why, you have to go back to 1971.
I'm going to ask that we bow our heads in prayer. Every head bowed and every eye closed in prayer.
There was good news in 71. The Reverend Billy Graham packed a brand new Texas stadium for a revival. The Cowboys would make it to the Super Bowl. But we also needed prayer. When burglars murdered three sheriff deputies, police first went to the wrong house, shot an innocent Latino couple with no connection to the crime. Anger simmered for 2 years until a Dallas police officer shot and killed a handcuffed 12-year-old boy named Santos Rodriguez. It also sparked something else.
Appeasement, ladies and gentlemen, is not leadership. Appeasement has never been leadership.
Over time, a more vocal, assertive leadership emerged among minorities, talking briefly about a black-brown coalition demanding better political representation and promising to fight police abuse. In 1986, when Dallas Police Corporal Gary Blair got into a struggle with two men during a traffic stop, Blair and one of the men killed each other. Fellow officers sang his praises.
This is Bill Brown. Corporal Gary Reeves Blair was 30 years old, and he must have been quite a guy. He was full of life, as friends say, with a great sense of humor. He loved to hunt and fish and ride in rodeos. The Southwest Substation in Oak Cliff was home to Blair for most of the 4.5 years he was on the force. Today, the flags hang at half staff. Inside, it's pretty quiet, not much being said. Every officer has black tape across his badge, the police sign of mourning. Officer Reed Maynard works at Southwest. He knew Gary Blair. He calls him a fine street officer who was so good, he trained the other men.
I can still see his face, the way he always used to smile and cut up.
How do you think Gary Blair will be remembered?
With a great deal of respect and fondness.
When questions emerged about Gary Blair's character, and council members Al Lipscomb, Diane Ragsdale, openly supported a defense fund for the third man on the scene the night Blair died, angry officers fed up with broken City Hall promises took their frustrations to the city council chambers, where reporter Brad Watson watched it all unfold.
The rowdy, noisy officers crammed the council chamber and demanded Lipscomb and Ragsdale apologize, and the council censured them.
The most proper action for Mr. Lipscomb and Ms. Ragsdale to take after their apology would be for both to resign from the City Council of Dallas. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
The police confronted the council, but they didn't want to stay for the response and trudged toward the doors. Lipscomb then pointed out the Dallas Morning News found minorities systematically removed from juries.
With the so-called jury selecting system, which still prevails, that is, no Jews, African Americans, or Mexican Americans. It is the epitome of absurdity. and naivete to keep saying the present criminal justice system is adequate.
Police and their opponents did both worry about crime. Crack cocaine and the dealers who sold it fueled unprecedented levels of violence. But even working together could be deadly when an elderly armed South Dallas resident named Etta Collins phoned in a possible burglary in progress next door. Arriving officers claimed she fired at them, so they fired back, killing her. That year, Dallas police shot and killed 10 people, the highest rate of deadly force among America's top 10 cities. That brought a House subcommittee in from Washington in 1987 to hold hearings. No sooner were they gone, responding officers accidentally shot another armed elderly South Dallas resident who had called in a crime in progress. Surely, people reasoned, 88 could only get better.
Welcome back. We're looking back at the worst year of tragedy for Dallas police before this one, a year of troubling relations between police, politicians, and minority communities. 1988.
A chill greeted Cotton Bowl parade marchers that year. All the marchers, all the assembled crowd forced to bundle up.
How cold was it? Below freezing when some of these hardcore parade fans came down early to grab the best spots.
At Dallas City Hall, the struggle for more representation, a civilian police review board, continued. Minorities and officers both wanted Police Chief Billy Prince out. Too lenient on bad officers, activists complained. Not supportive enough of the good ones, according to the force. Both would get their wish in April. In the meantime, there would be no peace. 14 days into the new year, as Channel 8's Quinn Matthews reported, Dallas lost an officer.
8:40 p.m., Officer James Joe got a report of a burglary in progress. He was off duty but was on call as an assistant manager at the complex. He called police first, then went to the apartment in question. There was gunfire. Joe was mortally wounded. On-duty police arrived in time to chase the suspects in a car. One of the suspects, Bernard Amos, was wounded. He was soon captured. At the time, he was on parole for a previous burglary. Police are now seeking a second man, Gary Von Bennett, 26 years old, wanted on parole violation from a theft conviction.
James Joe, 5-year veteran, husband, father of six, died in the arms of his wife. We had barely taken a collective breath when, 9 days later, a second officer fell.
Saturday, they lost a soldier in the war on crime. Officer John Chase was writing a ticket when a former mental patient named Carl Williams took Chase's gun and shot him to death. A crowd urged him on.
You know, when you feel like nobody really cares whether you live or die, and so many people seem to express the sentiment that they want to see you dead, it makes you wonder whether it's really worth it or not.
The claim that some bystanders urged the mentally ill gunman to shoot John Chase sent a shockwave across the city. Suddenly, Dallas cared about its men and women in blue. As Bill Brown explained, coming so soon after the death of James Joe and the Gary Blair controversy, supporters were everywhere.
The marchers, led by the Citizens Offering Police Support, or COPS, urged every driver in Dallas to turn on his headlights, and many did. All of the telephones in the police system were flooded with hundreds of calls from people saying they back all those in blue.
We appreciate you calling because we need all the help.
To show their feelings, these women left their office and used their lunch hour to hand out black ribbons of mourning and back the blue bumper stickers.
Would you like a ribbon for the slain officers? Thank you.
Can I give you this
bumper sticker and this ribbon to tie on your car to show your support for the Dallas Police Association.
This council respects and appreciates and is very proud of our police department.
We're going to take to the streets, and we're going to draw a line, and we're going to tell those criminals that we're on the side of the police department, and that, by God, they better move out of town, because if they don't, we're going to lock them up, and we're going to chase them out of town.
It was not about race, they insisted. It was about showing respect for officers and the dangers they faced every day in what some called America's crime capital. A danger repeated the very next month, as Nangaplerud reported.
Just after 5 o'clock, Dallas police converged on Brancato's warehouse market on Singleton. Minutes earlier, Officer Gary McCarthy lay in the parking lot, seriously wounded in a shootout with 3 gunmen. McCarthy had been working a part-time security job here.
And he was escorting the manager from a bank, and as they approached the store, the 3 suspects approached them and attempted to rob the manager.
The store manager told police he made it into the building unharmed. The plainclothes officer did not.
Around the city, tension continued to mount. Police supporters on one side, activists complaining of abuse on the other. And as Gloria Campos explained, officers, sensing renewed backing, gathered signatures to force a council vote to abolish the Civilian Police Review Board.
Yes, we had 60,272 signatures.
And that would have been 3 times the number needed to force an August charter election to abolish the board. However, now another organization, the Unified Coalition for Police Reforms, supports another petition drive.
It appears that there is a sellout to the Dallas Police Association to appease them.
Fred Blair was alluding to secret talks with officers, talks that excluded some city officials and led to an unprecedented eruption at a June city council meeting.
Those in city council chambers said afterward, there had never been anything like it before. The emotional eruption came during the time when citizens were testifying for and against the compromise on the Citizens Police Review Board. Nothing in the long weeks of contest over that board has so clearly revealed the burden of fury borne by the two sides. Terry Kleinmeier, president of COPS, Citizens Offering Police Support, concluded her testimony. Councilwoman Diane Ragsdale questioned whether COPS was formed in response to the killing of John Chase, a white officer, or James Joe, a black officer.
Many of my constituents, I'm not talking about the proposers, thank you, ma'am. Many of my constituents, this was not referred to you, ma'am. Sir, thank you, very kind. I'm not asking for a response. But many of my constituents, legitimately, as well as some black officers, came to me and asked the question, why did COPS originate after the shooting of Officer Chase? Why not after the shooting of Arthur Joe? And I think that's a very legitimate question. And I think
please sit down.
And I think that it's extremely, just as this woman said earlier.
You mean she can rebut me, but I can't rebut what
she said?
She has
that's
not
been
asked
done
the question.
All along. All council members do that.
Please continue. Ask.
James Joe made a very significant contribution to the fact that our organization was formed. And if you will notice, any time we talk about our formation, we mention Joe and we mention Chase.
As an afterthought. Joe is an afterthought.
Ms.
That is
please.
Your
is
conception, but it is
Ms.
nothing
Ragsdale,
like
please.
The truth, ma'am.
Officer Joe is an afterthought.
Ms. Ragsdale, please.
Officer Joe is an afterthought. Did you cut through your life?
I would also like
Joe?
To address the fact that some council members will not
Joe?
Be quiet while
did
the citizens are on the stand and they are unruly and never
Joe?
Reprimanded.
No, you did not.
This is my 3 minutes.
Please.
Why are council members allowed to disrupt city council meetings in this manner? I am given these 3 minutes and I intend to use them.
Racism started from you. You did not put your lights on for Officer Joe.
Miss Ragsdale.
You didn't put your life on the line,
Miss Ragsdale. Your light is not on. Please. You are
out of order.
She will come over there and stand.
Have to go.
She will come over there and stand. Racist, you are. Racist, that you are. You are a racist, my child. And after the vote,
you are the racist, ma'am.
You're a racist.
You're a bigot. You're a Democrat. You come over here and explain.
You turn your lights on.
Get out of the car.
You should have to come over here. You are a racist. You practice racism. Joe was an afterthought, ma'am. You are too.
The furies presumably abated, the meeting resumed. The council members getting one last chance before the vote.
But I can tell you this, I've sat through just about the last one of these proceedings that I wish to do on this matter, which I didn't author, don't feel particularly interested in defending, and don't really care if it fails, but I do want it off the table.
But for most council members, the emotions remained, ranging from anger to outrage and even disappointment.
A city which tries to experiment on occasion with real democracy and then becomes quickly and easily unsure and frightened, reverting quickly to old established, more comfortable ways of handling conflict in private and without all the players.
Diane Ragsdale was excluded from a process. My constituents, who are poor, most of whom are African American, my constituents were not represented in a private session, in a closed door meeting, to, in essence, negotiate the rights of my constituents away.
We have lost this one. You will rue the day that you did. I'll guarantee you, before we get out of office, we'll live to see in this city of Dallas, you will see Madam Mayor calling the National Guard into this city.
It had been the mayor all along who led the fight to avoid a referendum on the police review board. It had been Mayor Strauss who authorized the private bargaining that birthed the compromise, and hers were the last words.
So I urge you not to think about working against one another in a referendum, but rather to think and to concentrate instead on working on those things that bring us together.
Matt Quinn, Channel 8 News.
All summer there appeared no common ground, and yet a sense of relief settled in. Police deaths seemed to halt at 3. It would not halt for long.
What I am is what I am, you, what you are, oh what. What I am is what I am, you, what you.
Hey, little water.
Hey, little water.
Hey, little water, listen. Hey, little water. Something's gonna get you, little water.
1988, 3 officers dead in a single year. Dallas instituted 2-man patrols to better protect them. But on August 2nd, even that could not save Corporal Walter Williams. He and partner Terry Caldwell returned to the same apartment to see the same mentally ill man for a second time. That visit, John Jones told us, the man also had a gun.
The harrowing scene is one the city has seen too many times this year. In each, different circumstances, but the same results. Officer Walter Williams and partner Terry Caldwell responded to 2 calls at the Weatherby Square Apartments. They found nothing at 9:15 on a reported theft. But just after 10, they returned to the same apartment on a disturbance call. As they investigated, they heard gunshots. A woman walked toward them, bleeding, shot once in the chest. Police say the officers put her inside the apartment, and then Officer Williams went to radio for help. Moments later, Caldwell heard shots.
And so again, the city gathered, a widow mourned. Three children lost a father. Walter Williams' death made Dallas America's deadliest city for police officers. Now, four killed in a single year, and it was only August. Bad news kept coming. That same month, 22 seconds after takeoff from DFW, a Delta Airlines jet fell from the sky. And before the year ended, yet another Dallas officer was gunned down. Brad Watson reported that story.
A parking lot where an undercover narcotics officer and his four backups hoped to buy 4 ounces of cocaine and then arrest the pushers exploded into gunfire. Police say the officer who planned to make the buy, 43-year-old Lawrence Cadena, sat alone in this car after one of the suspects told him another man was on the way with the cocaine. Four backup officers sat nearby in two cars, listening to the small radio strapped to Cadena.
The drug dealers decided to rob him. One of them walked over and fired through the car at him, or opened the door and fired into the car. At that point, the backup officers got involved in it.
They shot three of the suspects, including the one who shot Officer Cadena. Two other suspects escaped in a pickup truck. Paramedics rushed Cadena to Baylor Hospital, but he later died.
Lawrence Cadena had been an officer for 17 years. His son told friends and supporters he loved undercover work.
He said, "Son, if I can make a difference in one person's life, just one little kid, my life would be worth it. And I know my father made a difference.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. It's not warm when she's away."
James Joe, John Chase, Gary McCarthy, Walter Williams, Lawrence Cadena. None of them had much interest in City Hall politics. They just wanted to fight crime. So too Brent Thompson, Lauren Ahrens, Patrick Zamarripa, Michael Kroll, and Michael Smith, the crime fighters we lost July 7th. Charles Dickens knew none of them. But his Tale of Two Cities detailed the turmoil that surrounded each of their lives. History is not supposed to repeat itself, but sometimes, tragically, it comes very close. Thanks for joining us.